Okay.
Okay, this should be good.
Okay.
Great. And it's good full screen.
Right. I think we should start. Well, welcome all to a very special event of the Georgetown Center for the Constitution, co-sponsored by a lot of other organizations who I didn't bring up here to list, read off their names, so I can't tell you all the people that have co-sponsored. I know the Federal Society has and the American Constitution Society, maybe. So who else? Who else is? Pete, huh?
Georgetown Defenders.
Georgetown Defenders, yes. Yay. Good. So. Yeah. National Lawyers Guild. Yay. All right. So good. I'm glad we have all the sponsors. Is that it? Four? Fantastic. We're five sponsors. This is great. Well, anyway, thanks for coming. I assume all of you are familiar with the Netflix show, Making a Murderer. But in case you're not, or in case you haven't watched it lately, or in case you didn't see season two, although this is a trailer for season one, I think, I thought I would play you the trailer from the show, and then I will do the introduction of our very special guest.
The people that were close to Steve knew he was always happy, happy, happy. Always wanted to make other people laugh.
They didn't dress like everybody else. They didn't have education like other people. The Avery family didn't fit into the community.
Stevie did do a lot of stupid things, but he always owned up to everything he did wrong.
I think I had a good life until all the trouble started.
Penny Bernstein was everything that Stephen wasn't. So just think of the two of them side by side.
There was no real investigation done by the sheriff's department.
The sheriff told the DA not to screw this case up. He wanted Avery convicted of this crime.
There isn't one iota of physical evidence in this case that connects Stephen Avery to it. In fact, the sheriff was told by the police, you have the wrong guy.
Steven Avery spent 18 years in prison for something he didn't do.
18 years.
18 years.
DNA had come through indicating that he had not committed the crime.
Law enforcement officers realized that they had screwed up big time.
We were getting ready to bring a lawsuit.
It's $36 million. Manitowoc County itself and the sheriff and the DA would be on the hook for those damages.
They're not handing that kind of money over to Steve Avery. I did tell them, be careful. They are not even close to being finished with you.
Do we have a body or anything yet?
I don't believe so.
We have Stephen Avery in custody, though.
Are you kidding me?
The disappearance of Teresa Halbach remains a mystery.
Mr. Avery's blood is found inside of Teresa Halbach's vehicle.
Steve, everybody's listening. What do you want to say today?
I'm innocent.
If convicted, Steve Avery will spend the rest of his life in prison.
We found a key.
That key was scrubbed and his DNA was placed on it.
This is really strange.
What's going on here?
Halbach's last stop Monday was at Stephen Avery's home.
If he did this, maybe it was good he was in prison all that time.
Everything I've heard him say hasn't been the truth.
It was extraordinarily disturbing.
We went through this 20 years ago, and we're going through it now again.
In this criminal justice system, good luck.
You are probably the most dangerous individual ever to set foot in this courtroom.
The truth always comes out.
Well, I don't know about you, but that gave me chills. Anyway, I'd like to welcome to Georgetown Law Jerome Buting, Jerry Buting, who was Steven Avery's lawyer in the trial the original trial, along with Dean Strang. Jerry is a graduate of Indiana University and University of North Carolina Law School. Mm-hmm. And we're going to talk a little bit about his career at some point here, how he got to the position where he was the defense attorney here. So well, basically, there's three things that I want to talk to Jerry about today. One is the Avery case. One is his life as a criminal defense lawyer and what that would mean for some of you who might want to work in the criminal justice system. And then what are some of the problems with the criminal justice system that the Avery case has brought to light. And it's not the only case that's brought these things to life. And Jerry has written about other cases. And before we go any farther, I want to show you a copy of his book, Illusion of Justice, Inside Making a Murderer in America's Broken System by Jerome Buting. I just read this book in preparing for this interview, and I just can tell you it's a fantastic read. I used to tell students who want to be prosecutors that they should read Vincent Bugliosi's Helter Skelter book, because it's a very good book about how you put a case together. If you want to be a defense attorney, this is a very good book about how you should be as a criminal defense attorney. And actually, anybody who wants to be either a prosecutor or a defense attorney should read about the other side, not just about the side that they want to be in. So I highly recommend you get this book. It'll be a great read for you. So, Jerry, welcome to Georgetown Law.
Thank you. Good to be here.
Now, I don't know how many of you have been keeping up with this, but there's actually breaking news
in
the Avery case
after
all this time. So why don't you tell us about that news?
Sure. So I don't know if how many people have seen or been following what kind of issues have been raised on appeal, but his new attorney, Kathleen Zellner, a lawyer from Chicago who took over his case after Making a Murderer came out, she had filed a number of motions for a new trial based on lots of different issues originally in the trial court, which is what you have to do in Wisconsin first before you can go to the Court of Appeals. And while that case has been pending in the Court of Appeals, she lost initially in the trial court. The trial judge wouldn't even give her a hearing, which is kind of remarkable given the issues she raised. And that's one of the issues on appeal, is whether she should have had a hearing on the motion that she's filed. So while the case has been pending, she discovered that, a couple of things. There were some developments in DNA testing that now make it possible to test bones where back during the trial, that was really not feasible. Unless there was actual human tissue attached to a bone, it was very difficult to get any kind of a DNA profile. Well, recently there's been a new test called rapid DNA that was just approved by the FBI and was just used in the Camp Fire in California, where about 100 people died. And it successfully identified 80 out of those 100 people. So she filed a motion in December seeking to use that test on a particular piece of evidence that if you weren't paying much attention during the first, or at least during the Making a Murderer 2, you might have missed. But what happened is that there were a big issue for the defense at our trial was where Teresa Halbach's body was cremated. The state's argument was that it was in the burn pit behind Stephen Avery's garage. However, there was clear, undisputed evidence that her bones had been moved, because part of her bones, identified by DNA even back then, were found in a burn barrel in the neighboring residence, which was Bobby Dassey's residence. But there was other bones found in a quarry, and Kathleen Zellner now says also in a gravel pit a little bit some distance away from that. So at least three, if not four, different locations. The problem with the other two was that they were unable to identify whether they were human for sure. At the trial, the state's experts said they were possibly human, but they appeared to be consistent with a female pelvic bone, particularly in the quarry one, which was about a quarter mile away. But she could not make any kind of conclusive determination.
So before we go further, explain the significance of a pelvic bone found in the quarry. Why is that so important?
Okay, the reason it was important for our defense is that if, in fact, she was not burned in Stephen Avery's burn pit, if she was burned somewhere else and her body or her cremains moved to Stephen Avery's burn pit, then we believe that that was conclusive, frankly, evidence that he was innocent, because nobody would burn a body someplace and then dump the remains in your backyard. You know, that's just common sense. So we argued that there was evidence that clearly had been moved to the burn, some of them in the burn barrel. Why were they there? Our theory was she was burned somewhere else. The burn barrel, do you guys know what burn barrels are? Do you have them around here? Okay.
This is a Wisconsin thing, I think. Maybe Minnesota.
It is.
Maybe big, Michigan. Yeah. But we didn't have them in Calumet City, Illinois. So
okay.
Tell us what a burn barrel is.
Burn barrel is just a 55-gallon drum. They use them in rural areas all the time to burn rubbish, you know, all different kinds of things. And they're open to the elements. And so it rains, and you know, and the bottom there's ash, and it gets mucky and kind of. And so our theory was, and they're all over the place. I mean, they are all over the place, these rusty barrels. Our theory was that whoever the killer was burned her somewhere else, used this burn barrel to scoop up her remains, and then dumped it on Stephen Avery's burn pit once it became pretty obvious from the media that he was the prime suspect for the police. Aha, this is a way to frame him and just, you know, deflect the attention from us, potentially, or me, or however many people were involved. So anyway, we had evidence that it clearly had been moved because there was her bones were in two different locations. If we could have shown that she was actually, that this pelvic bone that's found in the quarry was Teresa Halbach's bone, then that would have really undercut the state's case. And in fact, in closing argument, so we argued that these bones appear to be a human female pelvic bone. That is what the state's expert said. Possibly. She could not conclusively determine. And they were burned to the same degree of calcination, so is the term they use, as the ones that were found in Stephen Avery's backyard. Well, how many burned women are sitting around in Manitowoc County? I don't know, maybe a lot in Manitowoc County. But we argued that that was very probably hers. The state, Mr. Kratz, the special prosecutor, got up in his rebuttal and said, I'm going to spend 20 seconds on these bones because they're not human, they're just possibly human. So, fast forward, she discovers this test now that could be done on those bones. If she could prove that was Teresa Halbach's, it would strengthen the argument, undercut the state's case, and so she first asked for...
And just once, on the legal question, the fact that this was newly discovered, in the sense that the technology wasn't previously available, is relevant to whether he's entitled to a new trial, for example.
Yes.
Right? This is not something that you could have known about when you defended him the first time around.
Correct. We in fact, the FBI used mitochondrial DNA testing, which was the most advanced you could do for bone-type material. And they weren't able to get a profile out of that either. So this is a new type of DNA test that was not available. Newly discovered evidence, you have to fit a certain criteria, but this would in all likelihood satisfy that criteria that could in fact get him a whole new trial on that basis. So initially she filed a motion to retest, but there's a separate statute for post-conviction DNA testing. And the state objected and said, we should allow this appeal to go forward. You can do that later. And so the Court of Appeal says, you're right, we're not going to remand it. Well, then in the interim, thanks to some amateur sleuths on Reddit, who everybody laughs when you first hear the idea of, you know, of Reddit, but these people have actually been, some of them very serious, and they've done some pretty good research. They discovered through open records type requests a previously undisclosed police report that Zellner did not have, and we did not have, because it was dated December 20th of 2011. Now, that's an important date for this reason. It turns out in this police report, they say that two of the prosecutors, by that time Kratz was gone, he'd been had his sexting scandal and he was dismissed from the case, two of the prosecutors and Wiegert, one of the investigators, met in the property room and removed these bones and gave them to the funeral home so that they could be buried, given back to the Halbach family. Problem with that, what appeared to be the quarry bones. Actually, it appeared to be a lot of them. And that's one of the issues that's unclear until there's a hearing. But they mentioned them by property tag numbers, and these pelvic bones appear to be, the quarry bones appear to be part of them. And so they returned them to, in essence, the hall box. What's not been disclosed yet, and I don't know it either, is whether the hall box buried them together or cremated them. But in any event, if they were buried, they would be commingled and there would be no longer any way to identify which came from where. And therefore, they would, in essence, be destroyed. That evidence would, in essence, be destroyed for any value in the case. The reason September 20th, 2011 is important, a couple of reasons. The Court of Appeals had just denied his appeal, his direct appeal, but it was within the 30 days for them to prepare a petition for review with the Wisconsin Supreme Court. And his lawyers were, in fact, doing that. And until that happens, or at least until those 30 days expire, the appeal is still pending. They did this without ever notifying Avery's appellate lawyers, and she had never even notified Zellner until these Reddit sleuths found this report that had never been turned over before. In addition, there is a law in Wisconsin that's like a bioevidence preservation retention act. Interestingly enough, the architect of it was Norm Gahn, who was the prosecutor, one of the three prosecutors in the Avery case, and who was present on September 20th, returning these bones to the funeral home. And the law requires that if there is any kind of biological evidence that might potentially have DNA in it, the police department must retain it for as long as the person who has been convicted, if they were convicted already, is in custody, which means Stephen Avery's lifetime. So what appears is that they violated that statute by returning this biological evidence and returning evidence that they themselves at the trial said wasn't even human bones. So there's this whole issue of, you know, why are they returning bones that supposedly aren't human so that they could be buried with human bones of Teresa Halbach, which raises the possibility that they knew something more, that they really were her bones, which they had also hidden. So Zellner then filed a motion to remand again, and three days ago, the Court of Appeals granted the motion, sent it back to the trial court. It didn't expressly order a hearing, but it's pretty clear that that's what's contemplated because they said that they want a decision on the merits on her motion for there's something called so if the police destroy exculpatory evidence, then there are remedies which could even result in dismissal of the case. In my book, I talk about another big case that I had where that happened. Many years after the crime had occurred and the state in bad faith destroyed evidence that could have pointed to a client's innocence. So it's a big deal if she can establish that this was, number one, either potentially, there's two different types of potentially exculpatory or just apparently exculpatory evidence. And if it's destroyed by the state, if she can make that kind of a finding at a hearing, then we'll see what happens.
But the I was going to ask you about the remedy. So the remedy is potentially
the remedy dismissal? Could be dismissal of the entire case.
And what's the chances of that happening in Wisconsin?
It happened for me in a murder case with a guy in custody 29 years, and it happened under very similar circumstances. Where there was a court order for preservation of evidence. Here, there's a statute for the preservation of evidence. In both instances, if they were violated, I would think the remedy should be the same. So, and part of that is based on if you take criminal law, I don't know what level you're at, but part of it's based on the premise that we can't allow the government to destroy evidence that might point to someone's innocence. That's outrageous government misconduct is what it's termed. And the premise is that a court shouldn't be party to that sort of misbehavior by the government. And you have to meet some pretty stringent burdens to get to that level. But if you establish that, then, you know, in fairness, even if it may seem unfair to the victim's family, you know, if in fact the defendant can't establish that he's innocent and the state has done something to try and hide that and prevent him from doing that, then courts are not allowed to participate in that fraud, basically.
So, news, breaking news on the Avery case after all this time. Just coincidentally, we'd scheduled this program. Right. We didn't know that was going to happen. So right. It's good to have, and later on, there is going to be a Q&A, so you'll be able to ask more questions about that as well as other aspects of the case that you want to know about. So let's talk a little bit about you and the path that took you to being Steven Avery's lawyer. I already mentioned that you went to University of North Carolina.
And North Carolina.
As for law school.
Yes.
And so what made you want to be a criminal lawyer in the first place?
Well, you know, I talk about this in my book that I similar to you, one of my favorite TV shows as growing up as a child was a criminal defense oriented or any kind of criminal defense oriented show. For me, it was Perry Mason and another show called Judd for the Defense that nobody remembers. And for you, it was it was The Defenders.
It wasn't Judd, Donna Reed's husband on the Donna Reed show, I think. Guy to play Judd for the whatever that guy's name.
Yeah.
So there was a show called The Defenders. I became a criminal, and everybody doesn't. They know you're a criminal former. You're a current criminal lawyer. I'm a former criminal lawyer. I was a prosecutor in the Cook County State's Attorney's Office trying felony cases before I became a law professor. And I went to law school just to be a criminal lawyer. That's the only reason I went, because of a television show,
right?
The Defenders, which was a father-son criminal defense team. E.G. Marshall played the father. Robert Reed, who ended up being the dad on the Brady Bunch, he played the son. In the criminal defense team. So that, yeah, so TV got us both into
that. TV got us both into. And for me, it was the idea that, you know, particularly with Perry Mason, he was like the champion of the underdog, and he would take these extremely difficult cases and settle them in an hour, you know.
But all his clients were innocent, except one.
Except for one, yes.
Whereas on The Defenders, they actually represented guilty people, too.
Yeah, yeah, which is much more realistic, of course. So anyway, so that got me interested in it. And then when I went to undergraduate at IU in Bloomington, they had a degree in forensic studies, which was all criminal law based. And so I found that very interesting. I went to college initially thinking I would be an astronomy major. within the first 2 weeks, so I took astronomy, like major level, 201 level, whatever they call it. And within 2 weeks of that, looking around the classroom with these people who really were not socially adept, they looked like they belonged on a mountaintop alone at night and looking through a telescope, which is what astronomers did back then. That's not at all the field anymore. I realized this would be a good hobby, but this is just not socially what I really want to do. So I switched, became a forensic studies major, got a degree, and then went to law school in Chapel Hill, and they had a criminal law clinic, which was still relatively new back then for them. Georgetown had a great law clinic that had really kind of started the whole wave of law schools doing that.
And I was in a terrific clinic at Harvard Law School. It was in the second year of, I mean, they had clinics, but they had a big trial advocacy program, a 9-hour program, which we had NIDA-style trial advocacy, ethics and clinic, where we worked outside the law school in the 9-hour program, which was pioneering, too.
Right. Do they still call it the Prettyman Clinic here in Georgetown? Yeah. Okay. So one of my law partners, Dudley Williams, actually went to law school here, and he was in that clinic. So anyway, that gave me an opportunity to represent real clients. And then I decided I wanted to be a public defender, so I went to Wisconsin Milwaukee trial office, and I was a public defender for about 9 years before I went into private practice. And so really almost my entire career has been criminal defense.
So let's talk a little bit about being a public defender, because many people here, let's just have to take a show of hands. How many are, first of all, not all of you are Georgetown Law students, perhaps, but how many of you are Georgetown Law students who are thinking about criminal law as a career? Great, great. You came to the right place. How many of you are thinking about being a public defender? How many are thinking about being a state or federal court prosecutor? There's a few of them. Okay, more than there used to be. So let's talk about being a public defender. How did you find the job when you were there?
Well, I did not want to go back to the Midwest, frankly. Growing up in Indiana, I'd moved to North Carolina. I loved the beach and the mountains, but there was just not the public defender program was pretty new at that time, and there were no openings in any of the jobs. So I did kind of I looked at some jobs on the coast, West Coast, East Coast, but there was a new program that had started up in Wisconsin, and it was a statewide program, which gave it more money. It was better funded, and the people that were running it had an excellent reputation. So I decided to go up for an interview, which took place at a bar. And that was a positive from my view. And so I thought, well, okay, I'll give this a try for a couple of years. I came back 6 months later. I had to take the bar up in Wisconsin, which most people don't know, but Wisconsin is the only state in the country where you do not have to take a bar exam if you went to either Marquette or Wisconsin law schools. But if you come from out of state, you do have to take a bar. So I had to study for the whole multi-state and all that. And then I figured it was still relatively fresh. D.C. was a place that I thought I might end up. So in February, I took the bar exam here, because you had to take a bar exam at that time to practice in the district. And I'm still an inactive member of the District of Columbia Bar all these years later, but I ended up loving Wisconsin and stayed there.
So, but what did you think of the public defender's life, the life of a public defender? How did you find that job? How did you react to that job? You were a public defender for how long?
Almost 9 years.
And so what was that like?
You know, it was great. I really, some of my closest friends remain my original public defenders, including my wife, who I met on the very first day as a baby lawyer, starting the same day that I did. You know, you find it's a little bit like almost like, I imagine, like a MASH unit or combat unit or something. If you're in an office that has good mentoring and encouraging, it's a way to really learn. When I look back, I laugh, because when I think about how old my boss seems so old and so much more experience, and he had like maybe 4 years of 4 or 5 years as a lawyer. But you're just in court all the time. And if you've got good support, which I did, they encouraged us to watch, sit in and watch trials when a big trial was coming up. Because you learn by doing, but you can also learn a lot by watching good people do what they do. And so, you know, we had high caseloads, and ultimately that was the reason I left the public defenders, was because the caseload pressures became more than I could handle or wanted to handle. But I thought it was a great introduction to practice of law. Whether you become, I mean, there are some people who went into the prosecutor's office after a few years as a defender. It's more common to be the other way, where someone's a former prosecutor and then becomes a criminal defense attorney, but it does go both ways.
Although it's unusual for a public defender's office to ever hire a prosecutor. A former prosecutor. You go to private practice, basically.
After. That's more common, yes.
Right, right. Yes.
We did have some, though.
So did you find now, we're in the advice stage here, because the issue is training when you get out of school. Now, you had training in college. I had training in law school. It was one of the, in our careers, at least, our law schools prepared us to practice, which was kind of nice.
Yeah.
And we have a great clinic here. My son went through the clinic here, and so I know what they teach here in the criminal clinic. And then he became a prosecutor in Brooklyn. What would your advice be for people who want to be criminal lawyers? Will a public defender's office or a prosecutor's office give them adequate training and how to do it right, as opposed to just throw them into the water and hope that they swim?
It's a good question, and it's going to vary a lot from office to office and program to program. There are still a lot of public defender programs that are just run by the counties. Some of them are good, but they struggle even more than the statewide programs do when it comes to funds, and that also means training. So do your research if you're interested in doing that, and you know, look around, ask others, and find out, you know, and of course when you visit the office as well, you can kind of get a sense of the camaraderie, whether there's a real collegial atmosphere of support. For a period of time in Milwaukee, I think they kind of lost that, but I think it's back now. I was at a bar that's sort of their hangout maybe 4 or 5 months ago, and three of them had just won jury trials that day, and everybody was in there partying with them, supporting them, celebrating. One came in who'd lost, and he was supported just as much. So
we had that too. We had a bar near 26 in California in Chicago where we would go and party or wait for the jury. We would go there and drink while we waited for the jury to come back. This is when drink driving wasn't quite the thing today. So you'd go in there and just drink until the verdict came back. Right. Then you'd go back, get your verdict half in the bag sometimes. So I guess we shouldn't say this on video.
I never did that. You can.
No, well, yeah. You know, you're in the big city, Jerry. So,
although actually there's an issue in the Avery case, which I can, now that you raise that issue. For like 6 weeks that the trial was, I don't think I had a single beer. But then finally, at the end of the trial, we do our closing arguments, the jury goes out, and they were sequestered at that point. They had not been sequestered during the trial. They deliberated for, half a day or something. And then sometime around 8 o'clock, we got a call from the court saying that the jury was done deliberating. They were being released to go back to the hotel. And so it was like a stand down. So we go to a bar, and Dean and I had a couple beers for the first time in, you know, however long, 6 weeks or more. And then we get a call at 9 o'clock at night, and it's the judge saying that there's a crisis involving a juror. And, you know, what do you want me to do? Should we, frankly, if I had it all over to do over, I would have said, well, we have to reconvene in court. But, you know, I would have had two beers in me at that point, which was enough to, you know, I wasn't thinking as clearly as I should have. So it's almost like you don't know whether, even when you stand down for the night, you're going to need to be sharp and figure out what to do. And ultimately, the juror was dismissed on a supposed family crisis. He's the only juror who has spoken to the media. You see him in Making a Murderer season one. He says he was kind of pressured out by some other jurors. And we chose to use an alternate. We could have had an automatic mistrial, or we could have gone with 11 jurors. Those decisions weren't made until the morning when we were more clear-headed and could speak with our client. But you know, the idea of going to the bars, and that used to be the way it was, where some people would really take verdicts when they were pretty hammered. And, that's not advisable. That's not a tactic.
Times have changed. Nobody gets hammered anymore. This is totally doesn't happen. I know that.
Right.
My students tell me that. So now let's talk a little bit about private practice and, after the PD's office and how that has worked out for you. You know, there's always a concern about making a living.
Right.
In a small private firm, you're partnered with your wife.
Right.
So how did that go? And what advice do you have for people? Because one of the nice things about being a criminal lawyer is that you can practice law by yourself or with a few other people. You don't have to be in a big firm. So
right.
Any advice or what's your experience on that end?
Yeah, if you're going to take the route where you're going to first be a public defender for a while and then go into private practice, do everything you can to make a reputation for yourself as a public defender and doing quality work, because that's what I did. And also that public defenders tend not to be joiners. They're loners. They work together collegially with others. But when it comes to like professional organizations, bar associations, things like that, a lot of them don't join unless they're mandatory ones. And then even if they do, they don't really participate. Get involved in that kind of thing, because that's how you get to know other people who ultimately might refer you business in private practice. And those are the best kinds of cases to get, are the ones, now all my business is referral. We have a website, but we don't have it to get business. It's more just as a information landing spot when other people refer us. And the best kind of clients to have are somebody who's already been referred to you by another attorney in particular. They come to you pre-sold. Now,
how did Steven Avery come to you?
Steven Avery came to me as a referral from his actually, both Dean and I were referred by his civil rights lawyers on the case that he had filed for his first wrongful conviction. And, it's harder these days, I think. Again, depends on what jurisdiction you're in, to go right from law school into a private criminal practice. There's court-appointed work, but it doesn't pay very well, and one of the disadvantages of that is if you're not associated with anybody else there's no mentoring. You can get training from other organizations like National Association of Criminal Defense Lawyers, various state criminal defense organizations, but it's much harder. And that's now some people I know who come out of law school, go into private practice, they office share with others who are doing similar, or maybe who've been out for a couple of years. And that's not a bad approach, because at least then you can walk next door and sit down and say, what do I do about this issue? Brainstorming the kinds of things that you need to do that you otherwise wouldn't do if you're just off, alone in your own firm or working out of your house or something.
So now let's talk about the Avery case. Okay. I assume everybody here, how many people here, is there anyone here who has not seen season one of Making Murder? One person. Anybody here who has not seen season two of Making Murder? More people, actually.
That's good, because I get trapped in season two.
not so bad.
No. One of the things you have to have a thick skin as a defense attorney is there's only three real ways you can get a new trial. If your client is wrongly convicted, and I really firmly believe Steven Avery was wrongly convicted, his appellate lawyers either have to have newly discovered evidence, they have to uncover a Brady violation, which is potentially exculpatory information that is withheld by the prosecution, or they have to show that there's ineffective assistance of counsel. And so, frankly, one of the easier ways for a court to reverse is to say, well, the defense lawyer messed up, than it is the judge messed up. So that's one of the issues that she's had to raise with Dean and I, and that's perfectly okay. Like I've said, it's a human endeavor. We all make mistakes. Nobody can be perfect in a trial. If those mistakes are serious enough that they affect your client's constitutional right to a fair trial, then he or she shouldn't be the one that bears the brunt of the punishment. And good lawyers, professional lawyers, if presented with that later, will say, oh, you're right, I missed this. And they'll come into court and they'll explain. And bad lawyers, and I do trials and appeals, so I know how to, I've raised ineffective assistance of counsel claims against good lawyers myself. And bad lawyers come in and it's all of a sudden, I thought about that, but we decided we weren't going to raise it. Well, you didn't do an investigation to consider this issue. And so, some people get real defensive. They think that if you're accused of ineffective assistance of counsel, that means you've committed malpractice, which is not the same standard at all. And so they're unwilling to admit the truth when they come into court. But I've never felt that way. And so anyway, when you get to season two, if you do, you'll see that there are some issues that she's raised, as well as issues later that involve Brady withholding of evidence and now newly discovered evidence.
Well, I don't want to be too complimentary here, but one of the reasons why I don't like watching lawyers on TV is how badly I see them do their job. In fact, when I watched the OJ case on the trial, I had to turn the TV set off every time the prosecutors did a direct exam because I thought they were just doing such a terrible job that it offended me. It offended my sensibilities to watch them work. Whereas if given the extra we were able to see in the series, I thought you did a great job. Every snippet I saw of the... Because they only give you snippets of what you're doing. Every snippet I saw was extremely competent. I really had great confidence that he was getting a defense this time around. And what she did raise later on in season two, you know, it's the kind of stuff anyone can miss, but it didn't go to the skills that were manifested in the courtroom, which I think really came through in season one. It made it a pleasure to watch. I mean, as painful as the series was to watch, watching good lawyers be good lawyers is fun for me. It's fun for me to see. So let's talk more about the Avery case. I asked how many people watched it so they know what I'm talking about. What was it about this case? Was there any? How you came in here? You were an experienced criminal lawyer when you took the case. You both were. What surprised you? I don't know what this
battery maybe.
I don't know. Can you guys hear this in the booth, the static that we're getting here periodically?
Someone's coming out, probably.
Okay. What was the biggest surprise? What was the thing that you least expected as you were trying this case?
You know, there were so many twists and turns. It was really remarkable. The case was already being prosecuted for about 4 months before Dean and I took over from the public defender. And so we knew that there were some things that were reported in, there's the key that's found only on the sixth entry of his residence.
Not doing it anymore. He's not doing it now.
Oh, but he still needs to change.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, is it mine?
Okay.
Sorry. All right.
I think we're okay.
So originally it's like, oh my God, they find, when he's charged, they find the bones in the backyard. There's spots of his blood in her RAV4. There's this key in the bedroom and all this really damning circumstantial evidence. And they had really misled the public. They told the public that the Manitowoc Sheriff's Department was not involved in the search. And in fact, they were involved in all of the searches. In fact, virtually every significant piece of evidence used against him at trial was discovered by Manitowoc County Sheriff's Department, who he was suing for $36 million. And, talk about a conflict of interest. So they were telling the public that they weren't involved, but then at the preliminary hearing, it came out that these two guys, Lieutenant Link and Sergeant Colburn, were the ones that found this key and walk into in plain view. Hey, there's a key on the floor here. You know, I was like, where'd that come from? Nobody found that before. It was the first day. This still boggles my mind that the testimony came out this way. They actually testified. So they said that that Calumet County was doing the investigation, not Manitowoc. Well, it came out that there were three officers who went into, actually four for a period of time, went into Stephen Avery's residence and searched. One of those was a Calumet officer, a sergeant, and the other three were Manitowoc. And the Calumet sergeant said that he was there for the purpose of watching the other three to make sure they didn't do anything, any funny business. It's like, I've never heard of any kind of police investigation where you have a cop watching the other cops to make sure they don't plant something. You know, why don't you just search it without those guys who are compromised? It's ridiculous. But this was the first day that watchdog was not there. He was busy on something else, and they put in this low-level deputy, the guy who says that it's possible aliens might have come in and planted the key. It's as likely that aliens could have planted it as these two Manitowoc guys. To which I had to ask whether there weren't any aliens in the room, and that became a big meme all over the internet. There was a lot of funny memes.
There's a lot of memes. You got a lot of memes going out there.
Yeah, there's a lot of funny. People have too much time, I think. I think when we discovered that, and then we took over the case, that made me very suspicious. And then I talk about, this is actually how I begin the book, that the day that I actually got on the case was the day that Brendan Dassey, the 16-year-old nephew, was arrested. And I'm actually meeting with Dean when the phone call comes in from the family saying he's been arrested and that he supposedly has confessed. The story then, the very next day, was the infamous press conference, which if you ever want to watch a funny video, Google Brendan Dassey press conference, because you won't find the original one. You'll find the extra sweaty edition, in which they make fun of Ken Kratz's fixation on sweat. But that press conference is when I first heard the story about what Brendan supposedly said. And, you know, maybe it's because I was already a defense attorney for 25 years at that point, I was skeptical. It sounded like really overkill. I mean, how many different ways? Stabbing, slitting of the throat, strangling, punching, all this different stuff going on didn't make sense to me. Didn't ring true. And, of course, by then, I was very familiar with police interrogation techniques, and I knew that they used this particular technique that has been criticized even long before Making a Murderer came out, called the Reed technique. But it wasn't until we actually got the videos of the interrogation about a month later that it became clear that's exactly what was going on. And one little side note on that, I don't know if the district requires that custodial interrogations be recorded. Only about half the states make that mandatory. And Wisconsin was one of the ones that did not until just about 6 months before the Brendan Dassey interrogation. They changed the law and they made it mandatory that police record any interrogation from the beginning of their custody all the way through. If they leave the room, the tape has to keep running. There's none of this stopping and starting, which some places used to do, where they would do all the coercive stuff off camera or off tape, and then they would do what became known as a sew-up confession, when they would then start the tape, and have the person repeat it. But so anyway, it's really almost a stroke of luck that the timing was such that his interrogation was recorded, because without that, Making a Murder would have been very different if you had not been able to see what really happened, at least the segments of it, in that jury room. And you actually saw more in Making a Murder than his own lawyers, I'm sorry, than his own jurors, Brendan's jurors, got to see. Because the prosecutors kept out a lot of the interrogation techniques that were used in the first couple of days of the interrogation. And Brendan's own lawyers, for whatever reason, chose to end the playing of the tape for the jury before all of that, the stuff you see on Making a Murder, when his mother comes in and he's immediately starting to recant and saying, "They got to my head," and Brendan's jurors never saw that.
Now, why do you think that was?
Supposedly, the jury was told, oh, there's just some dead space, dead air that happens after this. And there is about a 15 or 20 minute period of time when they left the room and he's alone in the room. And like I said, the tape has to keep going. But even that has some value, because here's a guy who's supposedly unburdened himself with this guilt he's been holding in for months of this horrible, heinous murder, and yet you don't see any kind of emotion. You see he's like twiddling his thumbs, you know, he's like wondering when he can get back to school so he can turn in his project. He has no idea what he just said. But really, I think what was going on, they had an expert who was potentially going to come in and testify about the type of coercive techniques that were being used by the police. And the state had basically threatened that if you do that, we're going to bring in rebuttal Mr. Reed Technique, who is the head of the Reed Company. John Reed, who started it, has passed away, but it's been taken over. And I just don't think they were prepared to deal with the cross-examination of what you need to do. Is, you know, you need to be able to show the jury why these techniques are coercive, why innocent people confess, because it's not intuitive. Most people, you and I, would never confess falsely to something we didn't do. But studies have shown, when you go back and look at the DNA exonerations, we've got hundreds of them now, and they've gone back to study them. And when it comes to juveniles who later were exonerated by DNA, it turns out something in the neighborhood of 43% falsely confessed when they were innocent, when DNA proved they were innocent. Why? Because they're particularly vulnerable to these kinds of techniques that are used. So
when I was a prosecutor, one of my jobs for 6 months was a felony review unit, which means I didn't go to court. I only worked with the police. And one of my jobs was to interview witnesses, interrogate suspects. And so I would do this actually pretty frequently during this period of time. And early on when I started doing it, it was one, and quite a few defendants did confess to me, or confess in the sense that they made inculpatory statements, whether they were true confessions or not. And in one case, I saw...
Did you have officers with you that could testify as a witness in case?
Yeah, well, yes, I always did have an officer. There was a prover there who could do that. And eventually, if it was a murder case, we would take a court reporter statement. So once they had done it orally, then I would bring somebody in and in front of a court reporter.
The sew up confession.
Sew it up. Right? We didn't have that phrase, but I knew what you were talking about. So, but in the early stages when I was doing this, at one time this guy did confess to me. I don't remember what the charge was, but I remember that he confessed to me. And when he did, at the moment he did, I had a doubt about it because I had realized that I had said something earlier in the examination that could have been construed as a promise of leniency, or which you're never supposed to do.
Right.
But it was sort of like, you know, this will go better for you. So I have no recollection of what I'd said, only that as soon as he confessed, I had my own doubts about whether the confession was authentic because I had remembered what I had said earlier. And that taught me never, ever, ever to go there again, never to say that again, because when someone confessed to me, I wanted to know that they were actually confessing to me and not just telling me what they think I want to hear because I'm going to help them out. Mm-hmm. So I never made that mistake twice.
Well, the other thing that a good detective will do is there's usually a holdback piece of evidence or something that's not known to the public but would be known to the real killer. You want the suspect to tell you that because and the last thing you want to ever do is tell the suspect that piece of evidence yourself. And you see that in Making a Murderer. There's this whole sequence where we talk about the public didn't know that she had been shot in the head, that they had just discovered some evidence of that. And Brendan could not give them that information. He kept hinting, you know, what else? Something happened to her. Something else happened to her head. Something else happened to her head. What else? You know, and he wouldn't. And he finally just comes out, who shot her in the head? You know, and that blew it. Any good detective will tell you that's the holdback piece of evidence you never want to disclose. You want the suspect to tell you because that's a way to corroborate whether or not it's true or not.
Right. I know people are going to want to ask questions, and they're going to ask questions about the Avery case. So, and you guys even can start lining up now if you want to go to the microphone to ask a question. I don't want to cut off question time, but I think we should spend some time talking about criminal justice reform and the types of systemic problems that lead to wrongful convictions of the kind of Steven Avery, assuming that you believe that he was wrongfully, assuming one believes, I know what you believe, that he was wrongfully convicted. What did this experience or any other experiences you talk about in your book, because the Avery case is not the only case that Jerry talks about in his book, about someone who was shown to be wrongfully convicted. What changes could be made that are realistic to be made that would ameliorate this problem?
Well, we could really take all night, all afternoon and night, to talk about the problems in the criminal justice system. But and one of the things I like about Making a Murderer is that it sort of was an awakening for America, really the world, about some of the flaws that we have in our justice system. There's chronic underfunding, and that's true for prosecutors' offices and defenders' offices, but it's much worse on the defense side. And that's a big part of it. But one of the things that is my pet peeve is junk science that's been allowed into the courts. And there's quite a bit of publicity about that. Again, when you look at the DNA exoneration cases, somewhere in the neighborhood of 20-25% of them, there was flawed forensic evidence that was used to help convict. It may not have been the only evidence in the case, but it was significant. One example now, hair comparison testimony has been used for decades. And that's where they find a hair at the crime scene, and then they pluck a hair from the suspect's head and look at it under a double field microscope, and then the expert's supposed to give an opinion about it was supposed to be limited to saying whether there's a similarity or it's consistent with, but many of them went too far and said much more than the evidence would show. And in fact, I talk about a case here in my book in which they used that evidence to convict a client, and then later DNA proved that it was not, the hair didn't come from the defendant at all, conclusively. So the FBI did a study about 3 years ago of their own analysts' testimony. And they randomly picked like 268 cases. And they went back and they looked. And shockingly to most people, but not to me, they discovered that 95% of the cases of their own experts, that the expert either falsely or misleadingly conveyed what he or she should have said the science could show when it comes to hair comparison testimony. So much, they were so concerned that they no longer do microscopic hair comparison testimony. The FBI has dropped it. Problem is, the FBI is a small percentage of cases in this country. The vast majority, 90-some percent, are done at the state level. And it was the FBI who taught all those people. And they continued, many of the states continue to use it. Many of them resist. So the Department of Justice, after this study came out, they sent a letter to every attorney general in the country and said, there's a real problem. You might have people wrongly convicted based on this evidence. You know, we're going to give you money to help figure out what those cases are. And all but two states said, no thank you. Wisconsin refused. They said, well, we have no way of knowing. We can't go back through our thousands and tens of thousands of files and figure out which ones had hair comparison. And the FBI said, look, we'll help you. Or I'm sorry, Justice said, you could use that money to help to create a database so you can go back and find these things. But they didn't want it. So junk science is a serious problem. That's only one of many. All of the pattern matching type of evidence, what you see in CSI, is completely bogus. Really, DNA is the only science that's used in the courtrooms that started in the scientific field and then came into the courtroom. Almost all of them, the rest, are created for the purpose of helping to get convictions. Many of them go back to J. Edgar Hoover, that old.
He was the original director of the Federal Bureau of Investigation, for those of you who don't know who J. Edgar Hoover was.
Who had a very notorious career of all kinds of corrupt practices. But at any rate, so about 10 years ago, the National Academy of Science came out with a study of a survey of all of the various forensic evidence disciplines, that is, things like you know, fingerprints, DNA, arson, ballistics, bite mark, you know, all these different things have their own little like fiefdom organizations. And they concluded that none of them, with the exception of DNA, not even fingerprints, had been scientifically validated using a scientific method. And they kind of laid out a roadmap of what you could do to help, you know, to go back and do that before you start using this evidence or continuing to use the evidence. And basically, all we've heard is crickets, except for fingerprints. Fingerprints, they've done a fair amount to try and bolster some of the validity of their tests. But and then in 2016, PCAS, the President's Council on Science, Advisors on Science and Technology, issued another report limited to the pattern matching. So tire marks, footprints, ballistics, tool marks, all of those kinds of things. And again, found these very flawed methods are continuing to be used without any scientific basis. And they had sort of laid out a roadmap, but nobody has really picked up on that. And ultimately, there was a National Forensic Science Commission that had been put together with a broad array of scientists, academics, prosecutors, defense, judges, that were looking at trying to weed out some of these junk sciences and maybe figure out and strengthen the validity of those that maybe did have some validity. But then when Sessions was appointed Attorney General, he disbanded that. Thankfully, some of it has continued in the states. Texas has the Texas Forensic Science Commission. To wrap up this long discourse, Dean Strang and I and Professor Keith Findley, who was the UW Law School, founded the Innocence Project in Wisconsin, we put together a nonprofit called the Center for Integrity and Forensic Science. You can look it up, CIFSjustice.org. And it's a completely nonprofit, non-governmental organization designed to try and bring back some of the, first of all, designed to try and educate the courts, judges, lawyers, defense, and prosecution, and to teach students. So in Wisconsin in the fall, Wisconsin Law School is one of the first in the country that will have this, where law students like yourselves will actually be able to study side by side with graduate students in the sciences, initially biosciences, and learn about forensics and the use of statistics in the courtroom, which is oftentimes misleading as well. So we have a whole lot of goals that we talk about on the website, but that's one of the biggest areas of reform that I'd like to see. It's one of the geniuses of this idea is that we're using law professors and law students and science professors and science students to do a lot of the legwork that would otherwise, so students could get credit to do some of these tests that would establish the validity or lack of scientific validity of a lot of these disciplines and create the database that's not there because people claim, oh, it's too expensive, we can't do this. Well, you can, it's just there hasn't been enough focus on it.
I have so much else I could ask you about. You have so much else you can say, but I don't want to, if I ask any more questions, there won't be any time for student questions. And I think their questions will be as good as mine. So does anybody have any questions? If you come to the microphone, because we are videotaping this so that your question will be recorded. And if you could identify, if you're a Georgetown student, what year you are. If you're not a Georgetown student, who are you?
Hey, my name is Eli, a 2L fellow Wisconsin. I'd actually be in Milwaukee this summer for my 2L summer. So super excited to see you guys, or you in particular. When I think of the, and you as well, but for.
Okay, thanks.
Step out. No, when I think of the, I love the documentary first season more than the second one. I have a lot of arguments with some of my friends, and then when we talk about wrongful convictions, for me to process that, does that mean more so that they convicted the wrong person or that there was insufficient evidence to, in fact, convict the individual. When I think of Stephen Avery's case in particular, I'm always like, unfortunately, like, I think he may have done it, but my argument to my friends is, with some of this sketchy evidence, it's just hard for me to think who else would have done it. And then I've been reading and listening to other podcasts that kind of explain both sides of it. There's a podcast called Rebutting Making a Murder, because it seems like the show itself is kind of one-sided, and I wanted that whole side. But my actual question, that wrongful conviction, is it, hey, there's not enough evidence, the state didn't prove their case, or is it wrongful conviction, they in fact got the wrong individual? And I'm sorry for rambling on.
Sure, that's okay. No, it could be both. But typically the term wrongful conviction is usually employed when there's evidence that the wrong person has in fact been convicted, not just that they didn't get a fair trial. That's not always clear, because unless there's DNA evidence, it's very, and oftentimes evidence, if there was DNA, the evidence is gone, like potentially this bone evidence has been destroyed. Or maybe it's the kind of a offense that didn't have biological evidence, like a sexual assault allegation where there's a touching, but maybe it's not even reported for months. There's not going to be any physical evidence that might prove or disprove the case. And the way our system is set up is there's all these checks and balances. It's called due process. And the idea is that, at least originally the idea was, and I talk about this in the book as well, that it's better that 10 guilty people go free than one innocent person be convicted. Now, John Adams actually famously talked about that in his closing argument when he defended the British soldiers who were accused of massacring American colonists in 1770, I think it was, in Massachusetts. Talk about defending somebody who was unpopular. There's our second president who did that. And the way he explained it is, look, we have to be sure that we do everything possible to try and only convict the truly guilty. Because otherwise, think about, these are sort of big abstract ideas, but you think about the social compact that governments have with their citizens. If it comes to pass that you're innocent and still found guilty, and that happens too often, then people are going to say, well, why should I even obey the law? I mean, WTF. I mean, I might as well, if I can be convicted when I'm innocent, why should I even obey the law? I should just do what I feel like doing, what's right for me. And if that kind of a philosophy ever takes root in a society, then we're really in trouble. And so when it comes to Stephen Avery, most of the people I've talked to who've watched Making a Murder and who've read and done more than just watch the documentaries, because you can find everything that happened in that case publicly online, all the transcripts, so you don't have to worry about whether certain stuff was shown that wasn't. You can read all the transcripts, you can read all the exhibits, you can see a lot of the discovery, not all of it, because some of it was never revealed, and make up your own conclusion. And there are guilters and truthers, the sort of divided into camps. The vast, vast, vast majority of people think Brendan Dassey is innocent. And I've always been convinced of that. There's just no evidence against him other than his confession. But it's a little more nuanced, maybe 50-50, when I talk to people who studied it or have watched the documentary when it comes to my client, Stephen Avery. And I understand that. I mean, that there is circumstantial evidence. There was bones, there was key in the bedroom, there was blood in the RAV4. They were all, I think, under very suspicious circumstances. But most people still, when they look at it, they think, even if he's guilty, he didn't get a fair trial. There were all these artificial rules and restrictions placed on the defense. We couldn't raise evidence that we should have been able to raise. And if the state is so convinced that their case is that strong and he's that obviously guilty, then let's do over with, you know, with a more balanced playing field and see what happens. That's maybe a simplistic way of arguing it. But so So there's actually, you mentioned wrongful convictions. There's actually two different kinds of registries. So there's a registry now of exonerations and DNA exonerations, and then there's a broader registry that's several thousand long now of what appear to be wrongful convictions that were reversed for one reason or another. And there, some of them, there are maybe some still some dispute about whether there was actual proof of innocence. The case I mentioned in my book ultimately was dismissed, but the state still refused to admit that he was innocent because they destroyed the evidence that would have shown that. And so was he innocent or not? Was he truly wrongful? So there's sort of a gray area where people are going to fall into different categories. Thank you.
Another question? Great. Hi, who are you?
Hi, I'm Victoria. I'm a 1L. So my question is, between seasons 1 and 2, I notice a bigger focus in season 2 on the science when Kathleen Zellner is recreating a lot of the evidence that the state puts forward. I was wondering if you and Dean ever tried recreating anything and what problems it might pose for Kathleen and her team and how valid what they recreated was.
Okay, so we had more experts than you would be led to believe from Making a Murder 2. We just didn't have the kind of expert that she used. And there may be some valid criticism, and maybe we should have used a blood spatter expert, maybe we should have used a forensic expert on the computers, different kinds of things like that. But for us, it's partly the difference in the status of the case. When a case is on appeal, and like I said, I do both, trials and appeal. When a case is on appeal, the record is fixed. Everybody's testified, they're locked in on their testimony and what the evidence is, and it's a matter of, can you pick that apart? Whereas before trial, there's also, and by the way, on appeal, there's no longer a presumption of innocence. And so you've got to go farther to try and reverse a case. You can't rely on reasonable doubt anymore. At a trial, you can and should be able to anyway. So for our purposes, our focus was not so much whether she was, for instance, to use the RAV4 example, the blood. It wasn't so much whether the body was thrown into the back of the RAV4 and whether that would explain how there's splatters on the inside of the cargo door. For our purposes, what was important was the fact that her body was in her own cargo area of the RAV4.
So explain the significance of that to everybody.
Okay. The reason that was important at trial was, our argument was that she was not burned in his burn pit. She was not murdered on his property. She was not burned there. And she was not shot in the garage. You know, they've used two theories. In Brendan's case, they argued she was murdered in the bedroom where there was no DNA or blood to support it. In Stevens, it was no, nothing happened in the bedroom. It was in the garage. Either way, why would they need to load her into the back of a car to drive 20 feet to burn her in a burn pit? So for our purposes, what was relevant and most important was that her blood was in the back of the RAV4 that proved her body was there. Exactly whether she was killed and bludgeoned was less relevant in terms of reasonable doubt in picking apart the state's. By the way, keep in mind also, and this doesn't come through in Making a Murder, at least I don't think so. We did not know. The state never committed to any theory of where she was killed until their rebuttal closing argument of the Steven Avery trial. And then, of course, in Brendan's case, they flipped it and did a completely different theory. I remember standing up in my closing argument and saying, unfortunately, the way the burden is, that I'm not going to be able to get up here. He's going to get up again, get to talk to you, and I'm not going to be able to rebut it. But I'm pointing out to you right now, we've been at this for 6 weeks. We still have not heard where the state thinks she was killed and how. You just haven't heard it. And you should demand that. And then, of course, he gets up and for the first time says, oh, she was shot in the garage. So, you know, there's just a whole lot of fluid moving parts that when you're preparing a case for trial, you have to decide. You don't know what is going to be, you know, what's going to be the most important kind of scientific evidence in a case. The other thing that came up later was the thing about the, I think this is in season two, about the pornography on Bobby Dassey's computer.
Right, in season two.
Yeah. Okay. So we, of course, didn't even know that. You know, they withheld that report from us. And some critics on Reddit and other places have said, well, we should have, they gave us the hard drive, a mirror copy of the hard drive. We should have hired a computer expert to go through all of that. Well, okay, either we were ineffective for failing to do that and he should get a new trial, or they should have turned over the report in the first place and he should get a new trial because it's a violation of the Brady rule. The reality is they waited 8 months to turn over the hard drive to us. They waited till 6 weeks before the trial. They labeled the report Brendan Dassey's computer when it wasn't. And to say, oh, you should have tested it yourself, it would be like saying in a cocaine case that they tested they find a white substance, they test it, and they conclude, oops, it's cornstarch. It's not cocaine at all. And then say, we didn't have to turn that report over to you because you could have tested it. You know, no court would ever allow that. And so I think that's a pretty strong argument that she has on appeal. I don't know if that answers your question in more detail than you needed. But.
Yeah, can I just have a real quick follow-up question?
Sure.
Do you think that her kind of DIY scientific study in season two will hold much weight? Because I felt like some of it was just her and her team going out to the Avery residence and trying to do the science themselves.
You know, it might. You know, it depends on the kind of, if it's newly discovered evidence, then they have to show that there's a reasonable probability of, you know, a different result, that it would have made a difference. And, you know, that's why there should have been a hearing on her motion. So first of all, so that the state can cross-examine her experts if they think that there's weaknesses in, you know, like the brain fingerprinting stuff. Until very, very recently, that had never been admitted in any court anywhere. Now, a court in Iowa, a trial-level court, I think, just did admit it. But, you know, that's the kind of thing that if she wants to use that as evidence of his grounds for a new trial, she's not really pushing that as a grounds for a new trial. I'm just throwing that as an example. The state should be allowed to cross-examine the defense experts and say, you know, how valid is your science? You know, the micro trace guy who's looking and finds little bits of wood on the bullet, you know, that could be very important. And that's valid science. It's a question of, can the state weaken the expert's opinion or establish that it wouldn't have made a difference in the outcome of the case?
I think the question is more about some of her demonstrations, her experiments, which are not science per se. Like when, for example, when they were trying to recreate the blood spatter by
the
having
mannequin, throwing the mannequin,
all
in.
That. I mean, it strikes me that the demonstrations of that kind, run by the defense, are not going to persuade a court for a new trial.
I doubt that alone would do it, because
that seems more like for TV, and also not just for TV, but to figure out what the heck happened. It's helpful to have a theory of what really happened, so then you can actually start doing some testing. But
right.
It doesn't that. But those sorts of experiments to figure that out themselves, I don't think, are a basis for reversal.
Yeah, and I'm not entirely sure if this came through in season two or not. But some of the things that she does on cases, I don't agree with her on this like opinion that I only defend people that I am absolutely convinced they're innocent. I certainly don't agree with her on that, but that's the position that she says she does. And so some of the things, like I think the brain fingerprinting and maybe even the mannequin she's doing to try and convince herself that the state's case is wrong and that he really is innocent before she'll it may not be ultimately something that she would push in court, but that may have been the early attempts to try and convince herself in Stephen Avery's innocence and then figure out where to go from there.
Thank you.
Yes, next.
Hi, I'm Sophie, I'm a 2L. I'm curious how, if at all, you think the Netflix series has affected the case, especially in the second season, now that it's less looking back and more kind of following along things, how they're unfolding now, and what we just talked about with these demonstrations, just the way that having this camera crew and all the attention has affected the way the case is playing out.
In terms of whether or not in the court it will actually make a difference, or in the public opinion?
I guess it's two. Part of it is all the public attention, but part of it is also I'm wondering if you think there are things that are being done because they're being televised, kind of like we mentioned with these demonstrations. Like, it helps us watching it to understand, but how much is that contributing to the case? I guess I'm not meaning to be so critical, but I'm truly curious, you know, are we seeing what's really happening, I guess? And
yeah, I don't know. I can't speak to what was going on after in most of season two. But I know when they were filming us for season one, we didn't do anything because we knew there were cameras there. We were just preparing the case and brainstorming on the case, and then they were filming it as it came in. Whether some of the experiments that she's doing were being done just for television in season two, I don't know. But it might also be, keep in mind that if she's going to present the case in court, a lot of it, you know, you're better off if you can do sort of visualizations. So let's see, there's a scene where the guy or a guy is shooting out in the desert. He's doing test fires and that sort of thing. Maybe you didn't need to see that. Maybe that the filming of that might have just been for television. But on the other hand, you know, if the case ever came to court, there would be testimony that I test fired these bullets, and we've become, certainly with jurors and judges come out of the same culture that jurors do, we've become a much more visual society, and you know, actually seeing demonstrative evidence of things being done. So she may have been doing some of that and recording it herself, and then separately the filmmakers doing it. I don't know.
I think the Reddit sleuth thing is really interesting too. Like, that certainly would not have happened had there not been so much public attention. Have you heard of a lot of that sort of thing happening? Like, regular people getting involved because of having to see the show?
On other cases or on this case?
Sure, in this one or other cases.
In this case, thousands and thousands all over the world. I mean, it's incredible. I mean, I've got like 100,000 Twitter followers all over the world now, and it's 24/7. I wake up in the morning and there's different time zones. All these people have been posting stuff. And it's the same thing on Reddit, where people have – the difference here in this case is the access to the actual source material. I mean, I've said this before, you know, if two minds are better than one, you know, thousands of minds are better than two. And Reddit people have found stuff that we missed, no question. And that Zellner probably wouldn't have picked up. Now, that raises the issue, well, maybe we should just, particularly with underfunded defense, maybe we should crowdsource investigation. And, you know, it can be kind of risky because you don't know which way it's going to turn out. But there's some merit to that. Practical matter, though, it's not allowed because you can't upload all your police reports ahead of time to the public. And so to the extent that this can happen, it would really only be able to happen after the trial is done. But maybe for appellate defenders, maybe it's that's the way to go in the future, is to upload everything that's already a public record and let people have at it.
Thank you.
Thanks. Oh, this, you're next.
Thank you. I just wanted to say thank you for coming to, hello, sorry.
Yeah.
Well, thank you for coming to Georgetown. My name is Kelly and I'm a 3L here. I was just curious on your theory of why other suspects weren't more thoroughly investigated. I feel like anybody such as myself who also went to law school after experiencing a lot of criminal law shows, you kind of feel like the people closest to the victim are usually the ones that kind of commit the crime more most of the time, I feel like. And so I'm curious why people like I haven't seen the season one in a while, but I think, was it like her roommate or her ex-boyfriend or something, or even like Bobby Dassey stuff with the pornography, why that wasn't more.
There's really only one explanation that makes sense, and that is that they wanted to get Steven Avery and nobody else. Mm-hmm. Because any police officer, and there were three different agencies involved in this, any police officer knows that when a woman is murdered, upwards of over 90% of the time, it is from usually a man in her life, in her circle of that's close to her, husbands, ex-husbands, boyfriends, ex-boyfriends, co-workers, you know, people close to her. They're not strangers. We have the stranger abduction, stranger murder type, but the primary suspect, Gone Girl, you know, they always look at that person first. And they conspicuously failed to do so in this case. And it really hurts the defense in so many ways, because by the time the defense gets on a case and you have a private investigator, first of all, sometimes the trail has gone cold. The real killer might have been able to cover up stuff. But even more problematic is that the people, you know, we don't have, except in a few states, two or three, the right to do depositions in criminal cases, to force people to come into court or into law office under oath and answer your questions. And so when someone gets charged and you're representing somebody for the murder of a person, you can't go to that person's family and say, and have an investigator knock on the door and just, come on in, tell us all about it. They're like, you're working for who? The guy who killed my daughter? And the doors get slammed in their face. But the police, for whatever reason, even though people really don't have to cooperate with the police, they think they do. And they have this aura of authority. And so the police, when they're first investigating, are the ones that have to ask those questions, those hard questions, of all those people in the inner circle. Did you have an alibi? You know, what were you doing at the time of the murder? All these things that, because by the time the defense gets on the case, you can't in most instances. You don't have access to that. Zellner, once Making a Murder came out, has gotten some more cooperation than we ever had. And that's good. But it was very obvious to me that that's why they didn't look at those other suspects. I mean, come on. She had a roommate, and the roommate doesn't report her missing for 3.5 days. I'm not saying that he's the killer, but, you know, that might lead you in another way. Then the boyfriend, who suddenly ex-boyfriend immediately moves into her house. And so all of these things, the Bobby Dassey thing. Now, the Bobby Dassey thing is a little different, I think, because they, at that point, were wedded to a theory, and they really wanted to get him, Steven Avery, and they really looked at Bobby as a key witness for the process. He was their star witness. He's the last person to see her alive before Steven Avery killed her. That was their whole theory. And had they disclosed this evidence, why wouldn't you disclose this the report? I mean, that's another thing that's just preposterous in this case. Not only did the state's forensic analyst go through the computer, prepare a report, which is they're not printed out reports, because what they are is they're like they're done through this software program called Encase, and they're like a PDF, and they're like 1,000 pages long, and they sort all these search, you can find the search terms, the times of day that stuff is downloaded, as long as it's in the allocated space of a computer. But So they have this report. Not only did they not turn it over, they deliberately never booked it into evidence. Fassbender, or Factbender, as some people call him online, just what, I don't know, have you kept it in a shoebox at home or what? I mean, come on. How do you not, you know, put that into evidence? You don't put it in evidence because you don't want the defense to find it. So there's just a lot of that stuff here that was could really point to no other explanation to me other than they were trying to screw Steven Avery.
This will, I think, because of our time. This has to be the last question.
My name's Rich. I was a law school classmate of Jerry's, so that makes me, I think, a 41L. How is it the state could argue in the Avery case that the murder took place in the garage and then turn around in the Dassey case and argue that it was in the bedroom?
That's a good question, and it's an issue that's come up in a few cases in American courts where they have actually found that to be a violation of due process. So where you see it often is in a case where a death penalty case, where in order to get an aggravating factor, an aggravating circumstance, there maybe is a couple of people involved or three people involved, but they want to make, in order to get the death penalty, they want to show that the defendant is the shooter. And so there's one case that actually where this was reversed and found to be a violation of due process, where the state in one trial argued defendant A was the shooter, not the other. And then in another trial, defendant B was the shooter, not defendant A, after there had already been a conviction for defendant A. And the court ultimately found that was a violation of due process and reversed. But very few courts have ruled that. And I have no good explanation why they should be allowed to do that. It doesn't ever seem fair or justified to me. They've got to pick a theory. If there's one crime and only one bullet, then it can't be both. You know, if the trial is supposed to be a search for the truth, then necessarily one of those trials was false, deliberately orchestrated to be false. You can't have it both ways. And to me, that rises, should be considered the kind of misconduct, governmental misconduct, that a court shouldn't be a party to. But unfortunately, it's hasn't been ruled that way very often.
One of the murder cases that I worked on was two brothers who killed a former cellmate of one of the brothers, and they both confessed. And their confessions were absolutely identical, except each brother said the other brother was the one that did the stabbing. And then they had to be tried separately, of course, because they were cross accusations. So I had to try each to a jury trial separately from the other. And our position was that it didn't matter. It was they're both culpable of murder, regardless of who did the stabbing. And so I don't think we took a position on, because, you know, we would have had to accept one of these confessions over the other. Mm-hmm. I had an opinion as to which one, who I thought did it. Mm-hmm. In fact, I actually think it was the cellmate. You know, the brother who was the cellmate killed his cellmate. But we didn't know, and it didn't matter, so we didn't say.
See, it becomes more relevant. It does matter in a death penalty case, though, where they're trying to show aggravating circumstances.
Right.
If you're the person who actually drives the knife in or shoots the person, that's a more aggravated than if you just happen to be standing by as a part of your crime.
So they were both helping.
Yeah,
there was robbery. Right. It was a robbery, homicide, robbery, a home invasion, robbery, homicide, the whole thing, but soup to nuts. And they were, you know, each was assistant the other. But actually, for who was doing the multiple stabbings, which is what it was, it was death by multiple stabbings. It was probably one of them, not both. But we didn't commit ourselves to which one it was, as we tried both cases separately.
See, that's better. It's more fair if you're not going to take a position. If you say, well, it could have happened in the garage or it could have happened in Steven Avery's bedroom, we don't know. But that's not what they did. They did it, you know, completely differently. And in fact, in Steven's case, Kratz got up and said, one man and one man only is responsible for Teresa Halbach's death. That's him right there. You know? And after we lost, I contacted Brendan's lawyers and I said, hey, and I gave them this case. I I said, you've got a due process argument here. They never filed it. They never filed any motion. So it was never even ruled on in Brendan's case, which is one of the ways that I think his lawyers dropped the ball at the trial level.
Well, there's so much more that we could talk about, but I think we need to wrap this up. I guess one of the sort of commentaries I want to make about your style, which I think came through in the series, and that is, I think when students, I know when I was a student and I watched television, what I sort of expected trial lawyers to be was very theatrical and dramatic, and I think if I had it to do over again, I would be less theatrical and dramatic than I was. I thought one of the reasons I don't think I was overly over the top, but I think one of the reasons I was more that way is I felt that the jury expected me to be that way, that was sort of their role, and if I didn't fulfill that role. But in the ensuing years, I've come to question that. I think calm, methodical, trustworthy is a lot better courtroom demeanor than what one trial judge used to refer, former criminal defense lawyer trial judge I worked in front of, used to refer to as strutting peacock. Mm-hmm. And you come in here, these guys come in here like strutting peacocks. He was a pretty decent strutting peacock. Yeah, like that. So anyway, I just want to say that I was impressed with both you and Dean's demeanor, which was exactly the same to the extent we saw what was going on in the court as you are today. I mean, you know, very calm, very cool, very deliberative. And I think the reason why that works is that it allows a jury to trust you, I think. And my view is that juries want to do the right thing, and they're trying to look to see who around the courtroom they can trust. Mm-hmm. That's when I was a prosecutor, I wanted to be that person. Mm-hmm. I wanted to be the person that they could trust so that they, if they wanted to do the right thing, they would do what I wanted them to do. Lots of times they'll look to the judge. Maybe the judge will be the person that'll tell them who to trust. But you want to be the person the jury can trust. And I think the demeanor that you and Dean manifested during the trial was that. And I would commend you for that.
Thank you. And if, you know, if there's a lesson for students, you got to be yourself. You know, there are you know, better orators in court than I or Dean. Although Dean was pretty good at just coming up with these, you know, swimming upstream and you know all yeah, these kind of lines that he would have just off the cuff. But
just tell him the swimming upstream one because it's in the book. But just tell him what that was.
At that point,
and then we'll, I promise we'll quit at that point.
Okay. So at the beginning of the trial, the state had piled on three additional charges. Then they were based on Brendan being the witness who was going to testify. Otherwise, there was no evidence of it. And we moved to dismiss them. And two of them did get dismissed before trial. And then we wanted a cautionary or curative instruction. We wanted the jury to be told that the state had made this charge and then admitted there was no evidence and dropped it. And Kratz objected, and I've objected to that. We don't want to start off this trial swimming upstream. If that's the way it is, it's unfair. And Dean just, you know, without any preparation, just got up there and said, you know, begging counsel's pardon, but the state is supposed to start every trial swimming upstream. And the strong current against which they're supposed to swim is called the presumption of innocence. And it was like, whoa. You know, good job, Dean. But at any rate, what I'm trying to say is, you know, you got to be yourself. If jurors, I think, can sense if you're just trying to pretend to be somebody. I think Kratz, actually, it was, you know, he has this kind of, my daughter calls it the girly voice, you know, it's this higher lady voice that was really, it kicked an extra level up when he would be questioning, doing a direct examination of one of the citizens. And it's almost as if, I feel so bad that you have to sit through this trial, and it's that bad guy over there who's exercising his right to a trial, it's his fault. And it just seemed so fake to me that I couldn't believe the jury didn't see through that. And they probably did. I doubt if you talk to the jurors, he probably wasn't well-liked. But the point is, you jurors sense that, and if you're not yourself, they're going to sense that too. And that, and going beyond just a trial arena, you know, the theatrics of the courtroom, you have to be yourself as a lawyer too. And your integrity and your trustworthiness is your currency as a lawyer, as your career. If you try to cut corners one time and get caught cheating, sexting a domestic violence person, or, you know, but whatever.
Just misrepresenting to the court.
If you misrepresent to the court, if you try and pull a fast one and get caught, then that sticks to you like stink for the rest of your career. And it is never worth it. No case is worth that much that you should ever stoop to that level. So be yourself, maintain your integrity, and, you know, that's how you'll succeed.
Well, with that, before we thank Jerry for coming all the way from Milwaukee just to be with us today, just want to promote his book one more time, The Illusions of Justice. Illusion of Justice, Inside Making a Murderer and America's Broken System. It's a great read. It's about more than the Avery case. It's about other cases, and then it's about the legal system, as well as his own life. It's an autobiography as well, and it's a great read. And so thank you, Jerry.
Thank you.
Oh, and the next program of the Georgetown Center for the Constitution is Professor James Duane of Regent Law School, who will give his talk on why you should never talk to the police, because you have a right to remain innocent. And it's his great little book. I highly recommend it. It is going to be a talk that could potentially be of personal value to you in your life or the life of someone you know. So come to that talk. When is it, Fran? March 21st. Great.
All my old classmates.
I know. Did you know?